Part 4.
Which pile if they could afford to do so. So this is a very large number of sort of middle income parents across the UK who can afford a tutor. It may be a bit of a stretch, but they can afford £400 a term, but they couldn't possibly afford 4,000. Half of all families in London have private tutors for their families, for their children.
I can't believe that statistic. Half of all families
half
in London.
Do. And in the greater metropolitan areas, for example, in London.
Are these children, are their parents, buying a better education or a competitive advantage?
Well, it's not buying advantage. And if you argue that it is, it's about giving them a ladder.
But
it's
about not a buying stone. Advantage.
I think the term buying advantage has in it a sense of unfairness.
It's well, it is unfair. If your parents can't afford it, you suffer. That's the world. That's the way the world is. And they want their children to do better than other children.
It's not so much a question now of have and have nots. It's mixing and matching. Parents are combining state education with private education on the side. And that's really what's happening. It's become a fundamental part of British education nowadays. Someone referred to it as a shadow education system.
So, a shadow education system used by half the parents in London, parental choice, independent schools. If you want to jockey for advantage, there are plenty of opportunities. If, of course, you have the money, the connections, and the desire. And there are plenty who do. So, if we're really serious about narrowing the gap, what can be done? Here in Tower Hamlets, a very poor London borough, a school you'd imagine is almost predestined to fail.
Good morning. Right. Good morning. Let's get lined up, everybody. Let's get lined up. Profile of the school is 23 different languages. Off the scooters, please. Thank you very much. You can put them in the sheds. Almost 60% Bangladeshi community. Girls, come on, line up quickly, please. 13% white British. Excuse me. You need to take him out. You're not allowed to have the dog in the playground. 5% black Somalian. You need not to be up there in the morning. Hurry up into class. Good boy. 3% black Caribbean. Morning. We have another 3% of other black African. They'll be fine. You don't need to watch them. Mixed white, 2%, 2% Arabic. You need to be walking, put her down. Thank you very much. We have Turkish, Indian, white Eastern European, white European, Pakistani, Chinese. So how are you all feeling? Relaxed? Successful? Yes? Good, I'm glad to hear it. Greek, Vietnamese, Congolese, Nigerian, Hong Kong Chinese, Iranian, Kurdish, Moroccan. You need your hood off, please, school starting. Thank you. It's our community. Right, we can probably go in now. See you all later.
Daunting, eh? Who'd want to run a school like this? Well, the head teacher, Amanda Phillips. That's who. She relishes the challenge.
Some people use the excuse of deprivation. I can give you enough deprivation data to absolutely countermand the fact that those are excuses for underperformance. It's not good enough. Put your hands up. Put your hands down and listen to me. I'd like you all to say good morning to our visitors.
Good morning. Good morning. So who's the youngest here?
If you're in the nursery, wave to me.
Right,
hands
right.
Down, wave to me if you're in the reception class. Excellent. Year one. Year two, hands on your head. Ha ha. Very good.
Give us an idea of the kind of problems that many of the children who come to this school bring with them.
For example, at the end of our road, we have a huge park called Victoria Park.
Oh, lovely park.
Which is extraordinary and has had lots of investment. We've visited families of children who are living on the edge of the park where their windows oversee the park. And those children at the age of almost three have not set foot in the park to look at the trees during different seasons.
They have literally never stood on the grass of that park.
That's right. It's not an experience that all parents recognise that is valuable for children before they come to school.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You're all standing there as if you're not supposed to say a word. You're being wonderful.
You're incredibly. Are you always as well behaved as this?
Yes.
Don't believe you.
When you take children who've never been to the cinema before to their first film, the first thing that they do is scream when the lights are turned off, because if you haven't told them that, they don't know that that's going to happen. So every time you plan an educational visit, you are opening their opportunities to the world.
Whereabouts are you going now?
I'm going to London tonight.
You're going to London tonight?
Are you?
Yeah.
What you won't have noticed is that these are all boys.
I have noticed that, yes.
Nationally, across the country, some of our boys and young men are not doing as well as some of our girls and young women. So we've developed a project that encourages this set of boys to really, really engage in writing and in reading activities. And we're doing things with them that they really like on a practical level. And the buy-in from them is that they've got to be able to write about it afterwards and be motivated to write and show us just what they can
do. So in other words, you can't go to the London Eye unless when you come back you actually write about it, is that it?
Writing
is the currency to pay.
Yes.
Wow. Right.
We don't make any assumptions that every child has all of the experiences at each stage of their development, and so we try to expose them to that.
Now, one of the experiences that you had this year was to be taken to Cambridge University. Who would like to tell me the effect that that had on them?
A lot of us, we weren't planning on going to university when we were older, but when we went into university, it inspired us to go to university so then we could succeed in life. And that is kind of like, you know, into university is like a secret door to being successful.
And the children that you mostly mix with, do any of them expect to go to university, or do you think you're a bit different?
No, I think university is very good because it helped us by two ways. From giving us a qualification, giving us more better jobs. And if you didn't go to university, you went to college, you would have a job, but the job wouldn't be good. And if you lost that job, you have a plan B, which is a qualification from the university to get you to another job. So basically you have two plans.
So if one doesn't work, you've got the other.
Going to see Shakespeare at Regent's Park, going to City Airport to experience what it's like listening to the sounds and the air change when an aeroplane takes off right in front of you. Those are the things that make a difference between being a good school and an outstanding school, because you have provided those gaps in experiences, and it takes teachers and staff to go the extra mile to be able to provide that.
And it works. In its last report, Ofsted said Old Ford's results are in line with the national average and improving. A remarkable feat, it says, given the low starting point of many of these children.
You're obviously doing something right here. Why can you do it when there are so many other schools that can't?
Other schools can do it.
But don't.
It's about leadership and management. It's about having the right people in the right place. So being a head teacher is about leading, teaching and learning, and not accepting anything less than the very highest.
But there are plenty of rubbish head teachers out there. They're just not up to the job. They shouldn't be head teachers.
They're not doing a good enough job, and therefore they shouldn't be doing the job if they're not able to do it successfully.
Amanda Phillips does it brilliantly, which is why the school is so successful.
Part 4 questions. The money, the connections and the desire. Why are these things important for boosting educational achievement? The film goes to Tower Hamlets and says deprivation is not an excuse for underachievement. What does this mean? This part of the film focuses on in-school factors to increase educational achievement. Give some examples. And finally, the head teacher says leadership makes a difference. How does the film show that her leadership makes a difference in a poor area?